the silly, ridiculous waste of time they didn't want. That's why they were so successful. That's why they got away.
I've made a living in very dangerous.
Welcome to Diane Andrews in Black and White, and I'm your host, Diane Andrews. Thanks for being with us today. We're again out of our normal studio. We're in Houston, Texas, which we will and are happy to have as a part of the Diane Andrews in Black and White family. We go into 3 million homes. With Houston, we'll be going into 5 million homes on Access Houston Cable. There's been a lot in the news, and you have to be blind, deaf, and dumb not to understand what's going on in the news now about sexual assault, sexual harassment, and sexual violence. This show is dedicated to that. The name that I've given this is hashtag MeToo plus him, because 20% of all sexual violence is women against men and men against men, but the bulk of it is women, men against women. Harvey Weinstein, Roy Moore, Corey Feldman, and I have to give credit to Terry Crews, because he is the man who has come forth to talk about what him being assaulted at a party has done to him. If you look at the new magazines, you'll see him in the middle of about 50 women's pictures. And we also know about the children in the Catholic society. We know about other men, Kevin Spacek, who used his control to dominate little boys. Come on back, we have an attorney here who's going to talk about those terms and what they really mean legally to us. And we have a survivor of sexual assault. And I myself am a survivor of sexual assault. Come back to Diane Andrews and let's hear from the survivor and their attorney on what we can do and what the laws are about this terrible phenomenon.
How do you see the world?
At Shriners Hospitals for Children, we know that changing how you see things can turn them into
everyday miracles.
Like riding my bike.
Breaking boards. Ha!
Hugging my mom.
Every day for over 90 years, Shriners Hospitals for Children has been sending love to the rescue, regardless of a family's ability to pay.
If you know a child we can help, call or go online now.
Welcome back to Diane Andrews in Black and White with hashtag MeToo and him. The two people on the show that I discussed are here with me right now. Attorney Todd Slobin.
Yes.
From Shellest, Lazard, and Chauvin. He is a board certified, which I didn't even know they had, attorney in labor and employment law, 20 years in the state of Houston, Texas. He's also in the state of Texas, but he lives in Houston, Texas. He's also, which I had never heard of before, the Harmonica Dictionary. You're the producer of that?
No, I'm one of the producers of a harmonica documentary called Pocket Full of Soul.
And this is off the beaten path, but just 2 seconds.
Sure.
Tell me, it is really about playing harmonicas.
It's about the kind of the history and the players of the harmonica, and always been into music, and had an opportunity a couple of years ago to put it together with a good friend of mine named Mark Limpert, and he directed it. And
is it out there on YouTube?
It's all you can if you go to pocketfulofsoulmovie.com, you can find it, and it's a great movie. Huey Lewis narrated it,
But with all these other hidden talents, what his real job is, as I said, a labor and employment lawyer here in Texas, and specifically in Houston, Texas. But he's been nominated and has won Super Lawyer for many years from Texas Monthly. And he's also another accolade from another magazine, H-Town Magazine, which I had never heard of. Is that so Houston Town? And they call you Top Lawyer in that magazine. So we see we've got an expert who handles a lot of sexual harassment. In fact, he's going to tell you about one he's doing right now. And men against men, some of that, and sexual harassment of mostly of 80%, as we know, is women who are victimized, or survivors, as I want to call Denise. Denise Hamilton, sitting next to Todd, is a survivor, how I had mentioned in the beginning. She is originally from Brooklyn, New York, right? And she also went to Abilene Christian College.
University.
She worked for AOL. And lastly, before starting WatchHerWork.com, which is a digital platform for professional women, lastly, she was working in commercial real estate, and that's where this assault happened. Mm-hmm. By a person, as we were talking about before the show, who dealt in control, because he was controlling at that time $40,000 commission for her. We're going to get her to talk about that. As I mentioned, I am also a survivor, and I will mention some of my, I've had about four instances from assault to harassment. Attempted rape would be sexual violence, right? I've even had sexual violence. But Ty, let's explain what those terms mean.
Well, so I think most commonly, and I deal with situations in the workplace, is sexual harassment. And that's just unwelcome, hostile comments, behavior towards women. But it's the key thing is it unwelcome? Mm-hmm. And there are situations where both sides can come in and say that there's a consensual relationship going on. Mm-hmm. But a lot of times...
A lot of romance, real romance begins in the workplace.
There are, you know, but... What I deal with is when it becomes unwelcome, mm-hmm. and when it's hostile, and when it's based on comments or a job control or what's called quid pro quo mm-hmm. sexual harassment. You have to do this for me to get this.
Right. You know, people actually verbalize that to people.
I've heard all sorts of things. There are lots of power situations where you have a high-level executive, a CEO, CFO, president of the company requiring that his underling or... You know, even a high-level female executive do something mm-hmm. against her will in order to stay with the company or to get a commission or whatever it is.
Terry Crews, the guy coming over to him, groping him in the party with his wife with
him,
is unbelievable what some people will go to because of power. Would you say sexual harassment, as we talked about, some love begins in the workplace with sexual harassment or what may be perceived as sexual harassment, but people fall in love. If I ask you one time to go on a date with me or... make a comment. Bill O'Reilly is said to have called a woman of color at Fox News hot chocolate.
Yeah.
And he did it for years, but nothing was ever said. Let me tell you, if somebody calls me hot chocolate, I don't have a problem with it. Because when they stop calling me hot chocolate, then I may have a problem with it. But if she didn't want that, how do you handle that? These are unwelcomed comments. I don't want them. But if I do it one day, hi, Bill, you know, and nothing is said, or whoever the person is, and so I think it's okay, then who's at fault there? I continue to say that. It's not your name, but she really didn't like that, but she never said anything because he was a person of power, so how does he know? What happens in a situation like that?
Well, so there's a lot of situations where there may be a slight comment that such as that, that might not be, you know, considered sexual harassment. There's case law in the Fifth Circuit. We're in the Fifth Circuit of Texas,
and
where somebody said, you know, they asked somebody out on a date, and the court said, you know, that's not sexual harassment. A one-time deal. The right. person said, no, that's not sexual harassment. What you're looking for is something that is severe or pervasive.
Okay.
Severe could be a sexual assault. Could be a, you know, grabbing, touching, groping, or something along those lines. Pervasive is that comment every day. You know, where they say, when are we going to get together? When will you go out with me? When, you know, and if that happens every day and you verbalize.
But if I said nothing, let's say if I told the guy, hey, I'm not going out with you, you're married or whatever the situation, or I'm married or I have a significant other.
Yeah.
And he continues, is that when it becomes sexual harassment?
Absolutely. It's the key term here is unwelcome.
Mm-hmm.
You did not appreciate those comments. Mm-hmm. You told him that, you know, and he didn't stop. And what you're supposed to do next is go to HR, go to human resources, or if they have something. Most companies, and it's critical here, just sexual harassment applies to companies that have 15 or more employees.
Oh, okay. So small companies,
small
14
companies,
and less.
They are exempt.
EOC, can they go to EOC or
no,
anything with
if
that?
You have five employees in like a dental office, you see that all the time where the dentist may be making comments, but there's not enough employees to pursue a claim or go to the EEOC, the Equal Employment Opportunity
Commission. So they have no options?
They have no options unless it becomes an assault.
If they touch you.
They touch you, doing something along those lines. But what you should do, and most companies are going to have a harassment or sexual harassment policy with a number or an email, and that is you need to report it, and people don't.
I started my career as out of college at 19 with IBM. Mm-hmm. And a friend of mine, we were talking the other day, in fact, she lives in Houston. I worked here down at Riverway for 5 years in Houston here. But this man, an IBMer, came to her and he made some unwelcome comments to her. Mm-hmm. And she told him, look, we don't do that. We don't play that at IBM. Don't do it again. He never did it again. So is one pass, if they stop, then let's say 5 years later, she said, with all this going on, hey, I want to sue. I want to get into this sexual harassment game and maybe get some money.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Not specifically IBM, but anyone with this situation.
Yeah.
could she, when he stopped after the first red light?
So that, I don't think that would ever make it to a jury because it's not severe or pervasive. It's not hitting those.
It was just unwelcome, but not the other two, right?
Right, and it was a one-time event. Right. And again, the courts are going to, they're going to be pretty hard on that.
Mm-hmm. I remember when I was a little girl, I have about four, I was talking to my PR person, Sarney J, the other day, and I said, wow, I never even thought about all these. I knew it. As a little girl, my neighbor, who was, I guess, kind of perverted. My mother had told me his wife was a sweet lady. They were 7-day Adventist. She was. He was nothing. Mm-hmm. And she told me he liked to make little passes at little girls. And she had told me at 5 years old, if you ever happen to be over there visiting, Miss Ella was her name, and he attempts anything with you, you let me know. Mm-hmm. It definitely happened. And my mother was that kind of way. She always let her know and she took care of it. She went over there and gave him a piece of her mind. But again, when I was 15 years old, he called me in the kitchen but I can handle it myself by the time I'm 15. And he tried to hug me. He was just nuts, I guess. But that was definitely sexual assault that he was doing to me at that time. And then in college, another guy, a friend of mine, I went to get a ride with to go to the grocery store. I didn't have a car in college. And he was about 3-4 years old. He was friends, you know, just knew him from the community where I was from. He took me to his apartment and said, I have to stop here for a few minutes. Is it okay? Come on in, and, you know, for a second. I'm thinking it's okay. I'd been to the store. I had the food I was getting. And he ended up trying to rape me. And I fought him for over 2 hours.
Wow.
And thank goodness someone came in. And, you know, I never mentioned that to anyone in the community or anything. So I know how people keep it hidden. You just don't say anything. As a little girl, I knew to tell my mother to take care of it. But Denise, as we were talking about this, let's talk about what happened to you with this $40,000, because it was control. He thought he could control this commission from you, and when you were at lunch. Let's tell the audience about that.
Well, I've been working on a deal for several weeks in commercial real estate. If you're a tenant rep broker, it's full commission. So if you don't work, you don't eat. If you don't close deals, you don't get paid. And I've been working on this deal for several weeks and took a client to lunch, followed all the rules, you know, wore the boxy gray suit, you know, the very minimal makeup, you know, we had lunch, not dinner, crowded restaurant, all the rules. Really like 59 and Kirby, couldn't be a more busy intersection. We walk out the restaurant after the meeting. I think everything is locked and loaded and we're ready to go. He walks me to my car, pushes me up against the car and tries to kiss me.
And nothing during this lunch made you perceive this guy had these intentions.
I think
Denise is one of the 42 most fascinating people in Houston, Texas. So from the Houston Chronicle's point of view and a whole lot of other people, I'm sure. So I think she would have been able to perceive if there was something during this lunch.
You know, I think that if you're an attractive woman in sales, in an executive position, in really almost any position, you develop this kind of skill set around fending off unwanted male attention.
Right.
Like you said, at five, you ran to mom, but by 15 you could handle it
yourself.
Because I think that it's so endemic, it's so pervasive that you have to develop this kind of coping skill. So I'm pretty good at setting, you know, setting the boundary and setting the perimeter. But even me at 5'11, I'm still getting this kind of aggressive interaction.
You know, because it's a control issue, being a taller person may make people find it more of a challenge even. Because a lot of it is control, like rape. I did some shows on sexual violence. And a lot, you know, rape is not specifically about sex. It's more about control.
And I mean, it's tempting. You have the power to influence this person's behavior. I don't work for his company. I'm an outside vendor. So there's no real consequence. There's no real punishment,
Not for him.
Not for him.
Right.
So he, you know, he's going to take a risk at it. And you wonder how many women had he tried that with or had he done that to? And as we're seeing
that
now.
Audience, we're going to take a short break and we'll be right back on this most interesting show on all the sexual harassment kinds of people there are out there. Come on back to Diane Andrews in Black and White. Welcome back to Diane Andrews in Black and White. As we talk to Denise a little more about her sexual assault, because it was actually an assault because she was touched.
Talk to us a little bit more about what happened.
Well, you know, I've been working out, so I did my evasive maneuvers and just slid into the car around him. And I think he called me 100 times that afternoon. Just, wait a minute, what is she going to do? Who is she going to tell? Mm. What's going to happen?
And now, there were no words. When you slid away from him, what did he do? He just walked away and went toward someplace. You don't know where
he
went.
I don't know what he did, because
he didn't bother you anymore, right? Right. You were running.
Yeah, what he did.
But,
you know, I think that in that situation, you know, what do you do? Do you walk away from the commission? Do you tell his boss? Do you tell your boss? You know, we still live in a culture where the folks that bring in maximum revenue are valued above everyone else.
That's
you know, we're seeing it right now. It takes 17 women coming forward against one man, and we still believe the man over all the women. So what I did
was... Do you think we really do?
Do you think
we believe?
I really do.
Or just don't want to touch it?
I think we really do. I think that we've still, in this culture, we value a man's word.
Well, I guess some of it, and I pretty much I agree with that, but you are you are not guilty until proven innocent. You are innocent until proven guilty.
Mm. Well, but if you came to my house and you tied me up and you stole everything in my house, and I called the police and I said, Diane did this to me, they're going to come and arrest
you. Well, if I tie you up and I'm 5'2", boy, I've really been working out.
You've been working out.
I've been working out,
But your word that it was me
but
that did that
But that's a visual.
To you.
The police can also come in and see visually what happened in your house. Mm. If they stole all this stuff and all of it's gone. Mm-hmm. But he is, when he goes to trial, he's still innocent until proven guilty, isn't he, or no?
Yeah, no, look, you need to have proof in this day and age. And I'll tell you that when the smartphone came out, we saw so many cases where men were sending pictures of all sorts of stuff.
And what's his name, Wiener?
Yeah. All those, we had just an absolute influx of those type of cases. But men are getting smarter now with technology. Mm-hmm. They're realizing that they shouldn't text, that they shouldn't send pictures, they shouldn't email. And you see all these situations where they are getting smarter. But I had a case come in yesterday. President of the company continually has been writing to my client love poems. I love you, beautiful poems. But
he's married, and she's single or married?
She's married with 3 kids.
And he's married also?
He's married. She said, look, this isn't appropriate. You need to stop what you're doing.
Right.
He shuts her out for about 3 months. She tells him, look, I can't effectively do my job. She needs her job.
She's an executive also, or is
she's
in administration?
Just like a payroll person.
Mm-hmm.
She needs her job.
So he had total control over her.
Total control.
Mm-hmm.
She needs her job. She says, look, I can't effectively do my job. And he goes, okay, let's start anew. And she's thinking, that just means you're not going to be the pig that you are.
Right.
And then all it is he's starting anew with new poems, tells her he loves her, tells her he wants to sleep with her. And then it's gotten to the point where she's reached out to me to kind of help her out of that situation.
Right.
But there's
what an idiot. It's amazing how these very brilliant people, you know, they're executives of companies, they've worked hard, they have a beautiful life, but have this issue of control.
Yeah. Yeah.
And sex.
But absolute power corrupts absolutely, right?
It does.
If I can get away with it, I can do it, right?
But with all going on now, you think they would be smarter than to see people are going forward.
Most of these cases are people coming forward from the past. But I still think...
But on this one, though, Denise, it's not...
I mean, this is going on
right now. After he's an idiot.
Totally. Yeah, he's an idiot. You know, there's nothing you can do with
And she's told him over and over to stop. You have all these women coming forward and people coming forward.
But I still maintain that he's getting away with it. He's gotten away with it for quite some time because we don't believe women. In our culture, if it's my word against yours, it's always going to be the guy's word.
Well, tell me how will this go on? Let's say he denies it. But she's got the poems.
She
shouldn't have to have poems.
But
if
through the email, right? He emailed her?
If you're harassing me, if you're bothering me, if every time I see you, you say something like, wow, Denise, you're wearing that dress.
Yeah.
You wouldn't say that to Todd.
Yeah.
Todd, wow, Todd, you're wearing that
I don't
suit.
Know they said
as
to Terry Crews.
But
and Kevin Spacey with those polo boys.
What we have to do is get to a point where we believe women. It shouldn't take 17 people, 15 people, 21 people to come forward for you to say,
but let's say it's only one. But I go back to you with the proven innocent until proven guilty.
Mm-hmm.
It's one woman. This is one woman against one man. Yeah. How do you prove it if she doesn't have the poems? Let's say she wanted him. Now, let's talk about Indecent Proposal with Demi Moore and Michael Douglas. That's real, too. Mm-hmm. Women who have absolute power, which she did. I don't know if you saw the movie. Mm-hmm. We talked about it also. But, you know, she wanted him. And she used every trick in the book to try to get this man to have sex with her because she had control over his job.
Well, I think that,
Why should I believe him? In that case, nobody was believing him. Mm-hmm. And the wife didn't believe him.
Yeah. I think that when we get to a space that Congress is 50% female, Fortune 500
which is,
leadership
would go
is 50%
with the
female,
demographics of a country.
Right. When you get to a point where we have so many women in power that we've got to worry about this issue, then I will doubt it.
But I still have seen women that I know that go after men that don't want them.
Absolutely.
And they become revengeful to those men. And some of those men are married. I'm not saying it's pervasive, nothing like what's going on with women, but it does happen. And I'd hate to be the victim. If I were a man, too, just like being a victim if you're a woman.
Well, look, one really important thing is that the laws of sexual harassment have been around for a while. And they're not people, this doesn't discourage people.
But the problem you just mentioned to us during break was you only have 300 days to file.
In the workplace, you only have 300,
And harassment is basically workplace, but sexual violence is not the same.
Sexual violence is probably going to have a different statute of limitations. Mm-hmm. That's going to be more for like a personal injury attorney to focus on.
Okay.
But I would assume that it'd be a couple of years, but I don't know.
Right.
As far as in the workplace, you have 300 days to go to the EEOC to report your claim.
Mm-hmm.
And so there are times where a company gets involved to kind of help navigate the waters. And I'll still advise clients, look, you need to file your EEOC charge because if you don't, you're gonna lose that opportunity. It's 300 under federal and it's 180 days in the Texas state laws.
So you take the longest, which would be 300.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So the one that gives you the greatest amount of time. So you take the federal.
It gets really complicated as the state and federal stuff, but that's your backstop. And sometimes there are situations where you can go back and show some of the other stuff that happened prior to or with outside that 300 days, but it is really critical. So you'll see a lot of people coming forward, which I'm really happy about, but they're coming forward and say, this happened to me 10 years ago, this happened to me 15 years ago.
Is Texas a right-to-work state like Louisiana?
It is.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It is. Mm-hmm. But it's great that they're coming forward, but they're not going to have specific employment claims.
Mm-hmm.
But it is every voice, every person who comes forward is going to help the next person come forward.
Now tell me this case that you were just talking about, the lady who's got the executive, who obviously doesn't watch TV or social media or anything,
lives
to know
in a
what's
closet.
Going on in the world today.
Yeah.
She has claimed with you now. She actually has. What do you do? She called you. Does she hire you? What happens? What does she do the first thing?
Well, the first thing, whether she hires me or not, she needs to go and report it to HR.
So HR first. She hasn't even done that yet.
Well, it is a complicated case because she has now been given the title of HR. So
she got promoted.
Yeah, you get.
She's not payroll clerk anymore. She's HR
slash payroll HR. But that even makes the situation.
Is this a big company?
It's
or?
Not a huge company.
Okay. Over 15. Though.
Over 15.
Mm-hmm.
And those situations get even more complicated. But she needs to go to the EEOC. She needs to file her claim and see what the company is going to do. But the problem for her and almost every other woman or man that I've dealt with in these situations is they're scarred. Mm-hmm. Their job, their history, their future is not going to be the same.
That's right.
Absolutely.
It's just extremely difficult to recover from that. And you end up usually separating from the company.
Nobody wants to be titled as, that's the one that filed the harassment.
Then that's where you're always
and
known.
And you're always going to be taxed for that.
Right.
So it is a very, very difficult
Now what did you do with the, at your commercial real estate? You went in, did you tell people when you got back to the office?
I did not.
You handled it yourself?
I knew that, I knew the power differential. I knew that, no one's going to take me over him.
And if they do, they're going to say, hey, let it go. We want the $40,000. You want the $40,000.
Right.
We want the $2 million.
Or give this case to another agent and another broker. And
after you've done the work.
After I'd done the work. Like, there was no win.
Right.
And I think so often we have to be really careful that we don't tax women for their position in this dynamic.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I was talking to a woman the other day, and she said, when I was 17, I worked part-time during the summer, and we were showing a house, and my boss tried to grab me and kiss me in the empty house, just me and him.
Mm-hmm.
And I slapped him and I told him, you never do that to me again. She said, I don't really understand why women don't stand up for themselves.
Did he stop? Did she say
he
that
stopped.
That
he
fixed
stopped.
It?
But what I
like
said
like my
her,
girlfriend, I was telling you, talk to the guy.
But what I said to her was, did you have a car note? Did you have 3 children that you had to feed?
Right.
Did you have any consequence to your behavior?
That's right.
When you have a situation, you're a single mom. You have
you're
in charge of keeping the roof over the heads of your children.
Deadbeat dad's not helping.
Exactly. So you can say, it's easy to say what you should have done or would have done or could have done, but you need that job to live.
Right.
The child support offices are full of women. They're not full of men.
But remember what I asked Todd starting in the beginning, one time, and he did stop, who would they may believe or may not? If you know, that's a tough one if it's only once, you said. It makes it a little tougher if
it's a tough situation. Okay. And we had a trial one time where it was against a judge who was sexually harassing, groping, funneling the women who came into his chambers, his employees. We had a number of women who this had happened to, and his
did he have a slush fund like the representatives and senators in our money? We're gonna talk about this, and then we're gonna have to wrap it up.
Sure. Okay. His whole defense was he was a hugger. And he brought in all these women who were testifying that he was really a good guy. And we just drilled them and said, look, how many women is it going to take for you to believe that this guy is not a good guy?
Right.
And we brought in enough women to show that he was just really a horrible person.
Well, you can show a pattern and you can show activity going on with a lot of people in the wrong way.
You do what you can to prove your case.
Right. So. Well, anything else you'd like to leave here,
Denise? I really want to comment on something that he said. Like, we as women have to be very careful.
Right.
He never hit on me. Mm. I've known him for 10 years, and he's never done anything like that. That has nothing to do with it. Maybe you're not his type.
Yeah, like Matt Lauer and Savannah.
He didn't feel like he could get away with you. He didn't feel like he could get away with
it. Right, with you.
People, like, I say there's a Jamaican expression, monkey know which tree for climb. I'm born in Jamaica.
Right.
And it means that a monkey knows where they're going to get a prize.
Right.
So predators pick prey.
Right.
They pick
easy prey.
That they know they can get away with
it.
So don't, please, I beg of you, if women listening to the show, be careful. Don't be so quick to say, oh, John would never. Rick never touched me.
Yeah, he was nice to me. We're going to have to cut this and take a little break and come on back to Diane Andrews in Black and White.
Thank you very much, Hibernia Wealth Management in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, for sponsoring this episode of Diane Andrews in Black and White.
Welcome back to Diane Andrews in Black and White for my closing. If you keep up with Diane Andrews in Black and White, you know I usually light a spiritual candle, a white candle that I saw as a little girl growing up in a little town named Marouge, Louisiana, and it has stuck with me all my life, and I've tried to live my life by burning a white candle, and this is symbolic of how you live your life. The two great guests that I just had on this show, I think it was a great show, I think it was Todd gave us a lot of great information about how to handle sexual harassment, what it really is, how to handle sexual assault and sexual violence. I think Denise gave us some great examples of control and power. And then I told you some of my life experiences. And what we do, we take these life experiences. By the time I was 15, I could handle it myself. When I was 5, I couldn't. But Denise handled hers herself at the commercial real estate company. And I will tell you, if it's a one-time shot, you have to evaluate what you want to do. But if it's consistent and it's a pattern and this person will not leave you alone, harassment, as Todd said, is mostly in the workplace, is a workplace. And you go to EEOC, you go to HR. If you are HR, you go to EEOC. But take care of yourself. Make sure you live your life the way you want to live your life, and don't let anyone else control you. So thank you very much for watching Diane Andrews, and burn a white light around you and in your life. Thank you very much.
Join Diane Andrews in Black and White and Promoting Success Seminars on April 28, 2018 for a leadership and networking forum in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. Learn more at www.dianeandrewssite.net.
Diane Andrews in Black and White.